What'd you get?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner Master. At this time, we'll call the meeting to order. This is the second meeting in June 2012, Alamance County Board of Commissioners. We welcome all of you and are delighted that you're here. And we understand there's also a delegation outside that I believe can hear us. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. We welcome you as well. Just a couple of housekeeping items before we start the meeting. The restrooms in the courthouse are located in the basement. Go down this flight and then at either end of the hall, another flight down. This is probably the first time many of you have been in the historic courthouse since it was renovated. We had the grand opening last fall. I think the architects and county staff, facility staff did a wonderful job. So we're glad that we can use it tonight, and again, we welcome you. We will have shortly our public comment period. Just a couple of things. If you do have your cell phone with you and it's not on vibrate or less, if you can make that adjustment now. I don't want to be unfair to any of the folks that are speaking to have their input interrupted by cell phones. And also, while they are speaking, mainly so everyone can hear, including the people outside, if you could refrain from making any noise during their comments, and certainly you'll have your turn on the sign-up sheet as well. And just to reiterate, if there is anyone here that wishes to speak that was not able or could not sign up on the sign-up sheet, if you'll come forward now, we'll get that taken care of and get you added to the list. Commissioners, our first item of business is the approval of the agenda. Take just a minute to look at the agenda, including the consent agenda, and consider any item you'd like to have removed from the consent agenda. Just a small addition or an insert before we go into the public comment period. There have been a lot of different versions and variations of the numbers being tossed around. We thought it might be helpful to have our county manager just give a brief status on where we are today. That may help guide us through some of the comments that we'll be hearing. This is a public comment period that we are about to introduce. It's not a public debate and it's not a public hearing. Under the guidelines of our public comments, everyone can speak for a maximum of 3 minutes. You can speak on whatever subject that you want. I see a lot of them here have to do with the school budget, which is fine. But we do have an alarm clock somewhere. Where's that? In the back. Well, there you are. Okay. And we do, to keep the meeting going, would like to honor that 3-minute time limit this evening. Having said that, commissioners, any changes or other additions to either the agenda or the consent agenda?
I'd like to pull D.
Item D, Property Insurance Fund Financial Plan. Let's pull that and we can make that item between 6 and 7. Will that work?
Yeah. I'd like to pull A3.
A3, which is the appointment to the Fawcett Fire District.
Right.
Is that the one?
Right. Are they the ones that weren't here the last meeting?
Yes. Okay.
Commissioner Sutton, can we put that after the item D, the property insurance fund?
Sure.
All right. Any other changes or additions?
Mr. Chairman, the chief of Fawcett is here, and he will be ready to speak under item 6.
Okay. A3 pulled, and then since the chief will speak prior to that, we can decide whether we want to put it back on consent at that time. Craig, will that work? Any other changes? If not, I will entertain a motion to approve the agenda, which would include the items under the consent agenda with the exception of item D, property insurance fund financial plan, which we'll pull, and also item A3, appointment for the Fawcett Fire District. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Lashley. Ms. Massey or Mr. Boswell, second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you. So with that in mind, let's now turn to our county manager. And Mr. Honeycutt, if you'd like to give us a brief update kind of on the status of where we are as we then proceed into the public comment session.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and board. In front of you that we'll discuss is kind of where we left off at our last meeting. Susan, first slide. At our last meeting, after our public hearing, the board made a direction that there will be no tax increase for the 12-13 fiscal year. And the recommended budget, as you remember, was 54.5 cents. The board said that there would be no tax increase, so we cut that to 52 cents. By doing that, we had to cut $2.967 million in revenue from the manager's original recommended budget. And again, at that meeting, you gave me direction to come back to you at this meeting with a proposed plan. And again, this is the cuts, and also there was some new revenue from DSS. The state allocated some additional revenue to them to help some of the matching with DSS was $168,000. So the tax increase again was $2.966 million, cuts were $2.797 million, new revenue $168,000, and that left a change within the recommended budget of $2.966 million. And again, this is what we looked at from the recommended budget as what we cut out to get to this point. In the original manager's recommended budget, we talked about cuts to outside agencies, 6%. Now we have had to go to 7%. We had to cut out the COLA for all full-time county employees was $768,000. We had to cut out recreation capital, which was $59,000. That was basically to do some facility upgrades at some of our ball fields. We cut all of the sheriff's capital of $200,000. We had a fairly large contingency since we were looking at cutting it, our departments very, very close. We cut the contingency by $370,000. We cut the career ladder for steps for our employees. We cut that $392,000. Also, we went back to our departments and said we need some additional cuts. So we found $60,000 worth of additional miscellaneous cuts. The transfer to the revaluation fund. Again, we're having a revalue coming up. We don't have to talk about that now, but the revaluation we're starting to plan for. So that was $100,000. As we talked about before, we're looking at doing a lot of refinancing with our existing debt. That will be coming from the board within the next 30, 45 days, and that will save us $140,000. One of the things we went back and did is look at our existing positions that were open. What we decided to do on that was we have frozen six positions, and we have eliminated two. And that is a savings of $268,000. And again, as you're aware, our assistant county manager is leaving. And we have taken some of the savings from his salary as a cut as well, which is $54,000. And again, with all of those cuts that we went back in the last couple of weeks, that came to $2.797 million. And again, the previous recommended budget was $125 million, and that was the manager's recommended, which was presented to you on June 4th. And now the manager's recommended budget is $122,282,306. There's also additional options. The board wanted to look at other options as well, some a little bit deeper cuts. These cuts are not necessary to make the budget balance. However, they are options that the board so chose. If they didn't like the options that I recommended in the original cuts up top. We've talked about longevity, furlough days. We looked at furlough days. One day for county is $150,000. We looked at cutting weekend hours at the library. That would save us about $38,000. Basically closing Mebane and Graham and reducing the hours at May on the weekends. And again, we also talked about cutting athletic programs. It's not something that's mandatory, but it's an option that is out there that would save us about $150,000. School funding issues, and I guess this is probably where a lot of the discussion has been in the last couple of weeks, is trying to set out what exactly the numbers are. The state began by giving ABSS a planning allotment of $118 million. There's a continuation budget, and the state right now is under a two-year budget. If revenues had not increased, or if revenues stayed what they thought, they would have stayed with the continuation budget. And the funding for ABSS from the state would be $110,701,000. However, revenue at the state level came in much better than anticipated. So the House proposal, which was approved by the House, would fund ABSS $115,709,000. That's $5 million more than under the continuation budget. And if it funds under the Senate proposed budget, which has been approved, it would be $113 million. And again, that's $3 million more than originally approved under the continuation budget. And again, what I tried to do with this slide is show local funding, federal, and this is taken from their budget presentation, which is online for ABSS. And I think the most important number to look at is $171 million, because that's what they said they needed to operate with respect to the upcoming school year. So ABSS request is the original one on the left, and that's what they requested, and that's what they thought they were getting from the state, the feds, and their local request from the county. If you look at the state continuation, the House budget, the Senate budget, and the average House and Senate, the local funding is with the additional 7% cut. So that cut is already figured in. If the state continuation budget is the one that is finally passed, the schools would end up with $168,882,000. That would leave them short of their $171 million by $2.6 million. Basically, what that means is to get to the 171, they would have to use $2.6 million additional dollars. If you look at the House budget, when you add everything together, it comes out to be $173.8 million. And again, their original request was $171 million. So that means that they would have a surplus over what was originally budgeted of $2.3 million. Again, this is over the $171 that they originally requested. If you look at the Senate budget, which was not as kind to education, the budget would then be only $227,000 short of the $171, and that they would have to use, instead of $4 million in fund balance, $4.227 million in fund balance. But again, using an additional $227,000 would be $171 million. It would be what they asked for. And again, the average House and Senate, they're in conference right now. They're working on trying to come up with a final budget. I tried to do very simple math. Took the average of what the state, the House budget was, and what the Senate budget was,
The difference between 115 and 113 is 114. So even at 114, if they averaged out the House and the Senate budget, they would end up with $172.5 million, which is more than the $171 million they originally put in their operating budget. Next slide. And again, just if somebody wanted to know, Susan, if you go back real quick, this information is from the Department of Public Institution as of June 13th. So again, additional information. The original request from ABSS included a 1% reduction. The 1% reduction was added back, so the 109 became the 110 million. And again, the local funding that was shown was at 7%. This comes from the ABSS website and their budget presentation. And a lot of discussion has been said about ABSS losing funding from the EduJobs, from the stimulus package. Well, if you look at the EduJobs, that was already taken out of the $171 million to begin with. Susan, if you go to the next slide. This is from the ABSS website. If you look at the federal funding of $22.3 million, that is what they got last year. Subtract the $4.3 million in the EduJobs that they knew that they would not be funded is $18 million. And if you go back to the original, go back, that's what we put as far as federal funding is $18 million. So the $4.3 million was never part of their budget. It was already taken out. They knew that that funding wasn't going to be there. So that's why the $18 million is there. And that's what they listed as far as the federal funding as well. It still equals $171 million. Next slide. One of the things that I feel like is important to bring up, and this is in our budget ordinance, and it's probably, I asked Amy, it's probably the last 15 years. Basically, what all that says is we're not supposed to backfill state and federal funding cuts with local dollars. Is if the state and federal funds get cut, local dollars should not be used to make up that loss. And that goes for health department and DSS as well. So that says a lot, but basically the budget ordinance this year, the budget ordinance last year has same section 14, is that we don't backfill lost revenue from state or federal dollars. Next steps for the board. If agreeable to the recommended cuts, the Board of Commissioners will need to pass a motion which would set the budget for 12-13 fiscal year at $122.282 million with a tax rate of 52 cent rate and no use of fund balance. One of the things we did talk about before is since employees were not getting raises this year, is that we would add five bonus days to county employees. If that motion is approved, then this will become the final budget for Alamance County for 12-13.
Now the fund balance is gonna be 9.2% at the end of the fiscal year.
Amy?
At the end of this fiscal year, that's what we're estimating, about
9.2%. And you absolutely aren't going to touch that fund balance
next year. No, sir. There is no fund balance is used to balance this budget.
And right. There's no contingency. I know we had talked about putting that back in.
There is about 250.
I think about 266 is left in the contingency line item now after the cuts.
That gives a little bit of flexibility. Again, we've cut some internal departments. for utilities and gas, that gives us a little bit of flexibility if those line items went over.
There's got to be a mechanism here that within the first quarter, for instance, mm-hmm. if it appears that the revenues aren't coming in, if the expenditures aren't going to be held where we say we're holding them, that we have to reevaluate immediately.
Well, and that's what we did in October when we started getting fund balance figures in. Mm-hmm. You know, that's where we sent the letter to all outside agencies and said we wanted a 5% reduction mid-year. But the board decided not to do the 5% reduction, and that 5% was sent to the schools as well. So we gave them and put them on notice, but we didn't ask for it.
Susan, can you go back to the very first slide, please? Well, not that one. Keep going. All right, the second one. The next second one. There you go. Craig, would you list the major outside agencies that we fund? Not necessarily in order, but just who are they?
ABSS, Alamance Community College, the Chamber for Economic Development, mental health is $1.1 million now, or $1.2 million.
It's 1.2.
1.2.
The Airport Authority is $252,000.
So the additional 1% total for all those is that number?
Yes, sir.
And
right, that's not just a school number.
Right, that's everybody.
That is everybody.
And everybody is in the same percentage decrease. You're not singling out one group over another as far as applying the 7% or the 6%.
For outside agencies, yes. And again, we have cut internal agency or internal departments about 8% over the last 3 years.
And just for the folks that are here who may not know what COLA stands for?
Cost of living.
For the county employees.
For county employees. And again, as the board's fully aware, county employees have not received increases since the 2008-09 fiscal year.
Okay, and the combination of furlough days and bonus days in your budget compared to where we are this year is what?
Right now we have 2 furlough days within this year's budget.
The one that's just ended.
Between now and June 30th. There were 2 furlough days, which represents about 1% reduction of salary for county employees.
Okay.
And there were 3 bonus days.
So 2 to 0 and 3 to 5.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
They had 3 furlough days the year before, right?
They had 5 the year before.
5
which represented approximately a 2% reduction in salary for county employees.
But just as an aside, and he's probably not going to like that I'm going to do this, but you see the last line there, assistant county manager position. Tim Burgess has been with us since 2000.
Oh, 5 years.
Seven.
Yes.
So I think he's hiding somewhere, but unfortunately for him, this is the last public meeting we're going to have to wish him well. And I think I can speak for the commission when I say that we appreciate his service to us and wish him well going to New Hanover County. Where is he? Okay. Tim, wherever you are, thank you. Okay, commissioners, other questions for our county manager at this time?
There he is.
There. Tim, thank you very much. Okay. Thank you for trying to go. Okay, at this time we will begin the public comment period. Again, out of courtesy to those who speak, let's try to listen closely. I have a couple of sheets here for the folks that were here early and got inside, and because you're here early, we're going to let you go first. Then we have some folks that are out on the north end. Are y'all still there? Isn't that fun? Then you'll be next. Okay, so I'm just going to take these in order of the way that you signed up. I'd like to call on Mr. Dan Anderson. Please come forward if you would introduce yourself to the audience and state the subject matter that you wish to speak. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. My name is Dan Anderson. I'm Vice President for Communications at Elon University, here to speak about the budget we've just been talking about. My wife and I have lived in the town of Elon for 14 years. We have a son who graduated from Western High School and a daughter who's going to be a senior there this year. President Lambert at Elon University wishes he could have been here tonight, but he's out of town and couldn't change those plans. So he asked me to speak with you about Elon's interest in the proposed county budget and its implications for the school system. Obviously, Elon has the strongest concerns for the education of young people, both our own students and those in the county. And we believe great societies only remain strong through quality education. Quite simply, we believe that funding for education in our community should be your highest priority and deserves greater resources, not fewer. Well, what all other citizens of the county will make eloquent arguments about the impact of quality education on the lives of our children, I'd like to highlight another key consideration that has some big implications for our local economic development. We know that you understand what an asset Elon is to this county, and we enjoy the supportive environment that we receive here. As one of Alamance County's largest employers, Elon has a vital interest in recruiting and retaining excellent faculty and staff members. Students and their families from across the country and around the world are attracted to Alamance County because of the opportunity to come here and learn from world-class faculty on one of the nation's premier campuses. Now, a key factor in recruiting and retaining quality faculty and staff is the quality of our local schools. Our families pay a great deal of attention to the educational opportunities available to their children, and they're keenly aware of the financial challenges in our schools. For Alamance County to thrive and develop in an information age, we must provide the quality schools that our families demand. We want those families to choose to live in Alamance County, to buy homes, to pay taxes here, to shop here, to invest in the future of this county, and to encourage their children to become this area's next generation of leaders. Frankly and candidly, we have lost outstanding candidates who wanted to join Elon's faculty and staff, but they did not have the confidence in sustainable support for quality public schools. That's a loss to the university and to Alamance County. So if nothing else, this is an economic argument, a simple one. The investments we make now in our public schools will form the foundation of our county's economic future. This Board of Commissioners needs to send a strong message that local schools are not a place where money can be saved. You need to say that substandard funding is not good enough, that you place the highest priority on educational quality. And that message will be a big advantage to Elon and the other top employers in our work to help build the economic base of this region. We want to attract the best and the brightest employees. We want to brag about the quality of life here and let them know that this is a great place to raise a family. And we need your strong partnership in keeping educational funding at the highest possible level. If you make the decision to cut back on educational spending, you're choosing to set back economic development for generations to come. It's just not a good business decision. Elon is proud to be a partner with our local schools in providing quality education. Our students, faculty, and staff work hard and invest their time and their talents and their resources in local schools. And we hope you'll affirm our values and take the necessary budget steps to expand your investment in education. Thank you for your time. President Lambert says he would be happy to work with you and speak with you in any way. But I hope you've heard my message. Thanks again.
Next is Darlene Sutton. Ms. Sutton.
I'm Darlene Sutton. I'm here to speak on the relationship the county has to their children. I am Darlene Sutton, married 22 years with three children, ages 12, 8, and 5 years. My husband works at Wake Med in Raleigh, and I am a stay-at-home mom. My daughter attends Woodlawn Middle, and my other two attend Pleasant Grove. I volunteer at both schools, and I am concerned a reduction in funding would eliminate or diminish valuable positions and programs. My family and friends do not agree with reduced funding in our children's education, whether it is 10, 7, 5, or 2%. Our children's education is a success with the teacher assistance and special programs, which will be affected first if there is a reduction. My 8-year-old son has type 1 diabetes and has the help of a teacher assistant for his checking his blood sugars throughout the day and receiving insulin injections. Without the help of an assistant teacher to manage his diabetes, he could pass out and go into a diabetic coma. Because of the constant cutbacks, there have been delays in calling me for advice on highs and lows in his blood sugar because the teacher assistant was unavailable. There have been times when all the students were walked to the library to call me about his diabetes because there were no teacher assistants available. My school has many needs and has been last on the list for improvements and support because of size, location, and diminishing funding. If there are more reductions in funding, we will suffer greatly. The entry to Pleasant Grove has broken benches, peeling paint on the ceiling and beams, broken light fixtures, worn and rippling carpeting. The waiting area has chairs that are old, worn, and stained, not to mention too low to the floor for most people to sit in. The classrooms have insufficient heat and air, leaving one room hot and another cold throughout the year. There are shortages of bookcases, storage cabinets, and student supplies. There are broken ceiling fans and window blinds. The library has splintering shelves, limited amount of books, outdated resources, and overworn tables and chairs. The basketball court outside is very old, completely cracked up, and grass grows throughout the court. Tripping and falling are common because of the uneven surface. The playground has frequent stray dogs around the children because of incomplete fencing, and there's inadequate mulch under playground fixtures for falls. There is no sick room for the students to go to, waiting on pickup after vomiting, fever, tummy aches. Students wait in the office for long periods of time with illness or injury. The grass grows very high with flowering weeds, which agitates allergies and attracts many bees, which some attending students are highly allergic to. Please give our schools better funding to improve education, make our community more attractive, and increase home value, which will increase the tax base and overall funding for Alamance County. Thank you, and God bless.
Mr. Stuart Smith. Welcome.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, gentlemen and ladies. I would like to say, first of all, that I'm a resident of Alamance County. I've lived in Alamance County for 20 years. I am not related to anybody in the school system nor anyone who is employed by Alamance County. I'm going to read my comment, so I won't ramble, but I would like to state that I have concerns about the effect of budget cuts on our county. I honestly feel that our county employees have not had an advocate for them with budget cuts over the past few years. If I were a county employee, I would be very disappointed with recent budget talks. It appeared our county employees might get a 2% raise, then that was not to be, so we could hold the line on a property tax increase. As a taxpayer and citizen of Alamance County, I feel that our county employees work hard for us, but I hear no voice for them. We have asked our county employees to do more than their share. Other municipalities found a way to reward their employees. We continue to ask our employees to sacrifice. Quite frankly, I feel we're better than that, and I feel our employees deserve more than that. I respect our county manager for proposing that we not fill the assistant county manager's job to save money. These duties will be covered as a result of reorganization. I can appreciate that, but Mr. Honeycutt's a valuable man, and I, listening to the figures and thinking about how valuable he was, I hope we can cover it. Funding for our school system is also a concern that I share with many others. Like many citizens of Alamance County, I am trying to determine where the facts are. I have tried to research how much of a fund balance the Alamance County Board of Education should need. I researched an article from the Institute of Government at Chapel Hill, which states large counties should have 6% of their budgeted spending in a fund balance. It stated that a small county should have 8%. With reversions to the state, a fund balance is a moving target. Quite frankly, I can understand the positions of both the county commissioners and the school board with regard to this matter. I hear the commissioner saying to the school board that a policy on how much should be in the fund balance for Alamance County is needed. I don't know that I disagree with that. I can also understand the school board saying that is difficult unless the commissioners have a formula to keep money in reserve for our school property needs. I see letters written, attorneys have been called. I even hear talk of an arbitrator. I do hope we're better than that. I understand the challenges of dealing with these matters. However, the citizens of Alamance County depend on our leaders to lead. I understand each of the commissioners has stated they will not support a property tax increase this year. I can appreciate that. However, I know that we have needs that must be met, and we need support the great employees of Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to call Dana Roseborough. Roseborough, welcome.
Good evening. My name is Dana Roseborough. I'm an educator and parent of a student here in Alamance County, and I'm the president of the Alamance Burlington Association of Educators, speaking on the budget. 22 years ago, I chose my career because I felt passionate about educating young people. I felt that even though the pay was low and the hours were long, at least the governing bodies were looking out for the best interests of the children, parents, and schools in the community. Sadly, I've come to realize this is not necessarily the case. Our state and now our local government want to balance the budget on the backs of the public schools. In addition to the millions of dollars in federal and state funds, since 2008, we've lost $3.8 million from our county commissioners. And now, 1 year, you had proposed to cut an additional $3.4 million. What saddens me the most is that this incredible cut could have been avoided by a 2.5% property tax increase. My understanding is this amount would equate to approximately $39 a year for most property owners, the amount of one trip out to dinner. Instead, it appears that this board would rather have lost jobs and lost services to children and employees. It seems to me that the cost to the county for those lost jobs would outweigh the cost of that dinner. When teachers or instructional assistant positions are cut, those people will begin to draw unemployment. They may, at some point before they find another job, need public assistance for food and other needs. The activities that may have to be cut, such as the arts or athletics, may be the very activities that are keeping some of our students motivated to stay in school and graduate. Those students who don't graduate cost our county by receiving lower wage jobs or not being able to find jobs, resulting in more public assistance or more costs in our police and jails. I am perfectly aware that the county commissioners do not decide which programs and positions the school board will cut, but they can only choose from those which are paid for by county funds. The school system is being maligned for being frugal and accruing a fund balance. Those funds are being used. The board created a 3-year plan to deal with the shortfalls we would experience from the state and federal government. The fund balance will be down to about $5 million in 3 years, which will hardly cover the bills in an emergency. We have buildings in the school system which are over 50 years old. We have teachers teaching in supply closets and hallways. This is not an exaggeration. This occurred in my school. I myself spent around $300 this year for supplies for science experiments because budget cuts have cut out the purchase of science kits. We have teachers emptying trash, sweeping and vacuuming, and cleaning bathrooms after teaching all day and attending school data and improvement meetings because budget cuts have forced the system to let go evening custodial crews in some buildings. I know because this happened in my building. I realize that budgets have to be balanced, but I also know that a free and public education is not free. If you want the children of Alamance County to receive a 21st century education, then the citizens of Alamance County are going to have to pay for it. The children in this school system are the future of this county. It is the responsibility of the adults and governing officials to take care of them and to provide them with a quality public education. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Roseborough. I'd like to welcome David Smith. Mr. Smith.
I'm David Smith from Burlington. I'll be talking about the budget also. There are thousands of senior citizens in Alamance County who cannot afford a tax increase. There are also thousands of children in Alamance County who need to be educated. There are approximately 900 to 1,000 employees of Alamance County who haven't had a raise in a long time, and they do need a raise. I'm one of those senior citizens. I know a few of you are senior citizens also and proud of. I'm also very dedicated to having a good educational system, and I think my record in the past speaks for that. I went through the old Burlington system. I have a sister who is a teacher in the present system. I taught 2 years as a college instructor. I served 8 years on the board of trustees for Alamance Community College. I saw also as a county manager years ago, I was able to help increase the teacher supplement from 6% to 8%, which I think is still the supplement for the county school system. Now, how did that happen? Dr. Bridges was the superintendent when I was manager, and we were able to get together every year when the budget season rolled around. We met together several times during the budget season with our finance officers. We discussed for a long time what was needed, what could be done, and what couldn't be done. We did rant and rave. We didn't use any profanity, but there was disagreements, and we both knew that we were not going to be able to get exactly what we want. But we continued to discuss and to talk. We negotiated, and then we compromised. In 2 years, we were able to agree on the supplement increase of 2%, which was 1% each year for 2 years. It worked. It was a delight for me to work with Dr. Bridges. There were no surprises. Whenever the budget was presented to the board, there were no surprises and there were no confrontations because we did work it out, and I think that it can be worked out. I'm also proud that I was an employee of the county for 12 years. And I want to say that, in my opinion, the time has come that we need to stop trying to balance Alamance County's budget on the backs of county employees.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. That's 3 minutes. Thank you, sir.
No, for sure.
I'd like to call on Mr. Richard Johnson. Mr. Johnson? Welcome, sir.
Thank you. I'm a homeowner here in Alamance County. I've raised my children here. My wife was born and raised here. And I'm here to speak about the schools. There's been a lot of controversy regarding how much money is to be cut, which programs might be cut, and who is to blame for the cutting. I think most of us here are simply saying that as citizens, we expect our elected officials to deal with those management issues, that enough has been cut already from the schools. Perhaps the state government is at fault, perhaps our local leaders, or perhaps the economic situation. We feel that our situation, that our children have suffered enough with several years of school cuts, and we want the county commission to figure out how to stop this cutting and even to counteract cutting that comes from the states or the feds despite the existence of Section 14, which to my knowledge was not handed down by Moses on stone tablets and therefore can be changed. We also refuse to play the game of turning on each other and saying, cut that program, not mine. We will not fall into that trap because many of these programs are mutually supportive. Take cuts in music programs, for example. Research evidence shows that music programs actually raise math scores. Numbers are a system of symbols. Musical notation is also a system of symbols. Both systems require counting, as in whole notes, half notes, etc. And experiments have shown that teaching music to children helps them to develop the skills necessary to excel in math. The same holds true for programs for academically gifted children. By supporting such programs, we send a message to all students that excellence is valued in our county. Even students not in AG classes get that lesson. But by cutting those programs, we feed the idea that book learning is somehow foolish, that intelligence is somehow freakish, and that neither is valued in our schools. Now a word about possible cuts to dance and athletic programs. For the past several decades, we in this country have faced an obesity crisis in our children. When I was a kid, the streets teemed with children all summer long. No longer. Our kids have become more sedentary, and we do not see that anymore. Dance and athletic programs, by getting kids on their feet, can combat that program. Removing these programs is one more step away from helping our kids be healthy. But more importantly, we have to recognize that if kids are going to do well in school, they need to find some joy in school. If education is drudgery, they will dread education. On the other hand, they can find something they love, orchestra, art, dance, sports, history, books, whatever, then that can be the hook that not only keeps them in school, but makes them truly interested in being in school. That's why programs like these are vital to education and to the future of our community. Yes, they cost money, but cutting them cost us also by depriving our children the best education they can get, and perhaps by driving them away from our community once they grow up, because they see it as boring and they see it as shortchanging their futures.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you.
Next, we'd like to call on Mr. Billy Jones. Mr. Jones? Welcome, sir.
Thank you. The reason I chose to come in and speak tonight is because of a proposal that I read that was presented to you folks by the county manager regarding cutting some of the programs, specifically orchestra, student athletics. We've lived in Alamance County for 7 years. I have a son that graduated from Western Alamance High School last year as a rising sophomore at NC State. I have a rising freshman at Western Alamance High School. My youngest was fortunate enough to be a two-sports student athlete both his seventh and eighth grade year. As some of the previous speakers have said, if you take some of these things out of school, you're going to have people that don't want to go to school. They may struggle in school. And you may have kids that if they don't have the opportunity to compete in sports in school, their families may not be able to financially afford for them to compete in an extracurricular activity. Therefore, sports outside. So that is their only chance, because I dare say every parent here, they want their child to go to college. Now, granted, a very small percentage goes on an athletic scholarship or a band scholarship or dance scholarship, but isn't it our responsibility to make them have every opportunity to do that? And I know you as a commission do not have the final say with how the school system spends their money, but I know with this commission, y'all's opinion carry a lot of weight with the school board, and there's got to be other ways to fund this. And I know somebody may hit me in the head when I go out the door, but why not raise property taxes or something else and do this? I don't like taxes either, but I would rather take that out of going to dinner an extra time, as somebody said, than to cut funding for these schools and these teachers. We moved to Alamance County 7 years ago. I did a lot of research before we did, because we came from Guilford County, good school system where we were at, and I was proud to move to the Western Alamance District. And I'm just scared that things are going downhill, because nobody wants to admit it, but there's gangs everywhere. And if they're not happy in school and there's not things for them to do, by God, the gangs will find them a place. And where I saw the proposal that was proposed was in the Alamance County newspaper last Saturday. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. Ms. Grace Baldwin, Ms. Baldwin, are you here?
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, all you citizens and the board members. I'm here concerned about our students and our school board. I'm a 30-year daycare provider. I work 7 days a week. I work out in our community. And preparing children in daycare is not easy. But I can say out of 30 years, I've seen the children's morale, and they're wanting to go to school, and they want to learn. And cutting the budget will really damage their morale. And I was happy to see that you had come to some type of agreement, because I was very concerned of what I read in the paper. And I ran for county commissioner in 05, and I ran for mayor in 06. And I didn't run to win, I ran to learn, because my parents brought me out to commissioner's meeting when I was younger. And I learned a lot. And I'm giving back that information to the community and to children that I'm training, because I have my grandson here with me tonight. But I'm saying that cutting our athletic program will not be an answer. We need to pick up things for our children. Yes, the gangs are all over, and we need to listen. We need to listen to our body language in school, the dress code. A lot of things go on that we do see, but we ignore. But when we come together as adults, that's saying something. But when we bicker among ourselves, and it goes in public paper, that says something also. So I would think that the next time we have a disagreement with the school board, that we can work on this a little better without so much public in the paper reading, and children read the paper. We have papers in our school system. We have educated kids, they're on their way to college, and they don't approve of what they've read. I got calls from parents and also concern from students. But I'm glad that you all have come together and showed us something here today, that you are seriously working. Don't have anything to do with you running for your office, your position, such as county commissioner that I did read. Didn't have anything to do with that. We adults, we need to work together for the good of our community and citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Lois Myers. Ms. Myers, welcome.
Thank you. My husband and I have a daughter who has been in the Alamance Burlington school system for 9 years. Your severe budget cuts that you are proposing to all the agencies, not just the school system, are hurting our entire community. And you have a tool at your disposal to change this, and that is to increase property taxes. Beyond the numbers and the budget for this particular year, I'm even more concerned by the ongoing attitude of distrust and disdain that the county commissioners have for the school system. I've witnessed this attitude for the entire 9 years my child has been in school. That was long before we had a county budget crisis. This persistent lack of support for our educational system has put us in a position where we are racing for the bottom, not striving for the top. Because of this attitude, you are losing potential new businesses, and every day you are losing tax-paying families who have chosen another community where education is valued. This loss of potential revenue hurts everyone in our community, old people and young people. The Public School Forum ranks Alamance County 61st for its spending for education funding among our state systems. And our local funding per student in 2010-2011 was $300 less than the state average. We can do better than this. We need a community whose leaders support our educational system. We need this support so we can attract new businesses and retain the employees that those businesses could bring to our county. We cannot compete and we cannot excel with an attitude of we will fund the least amount possible and only what is required by the law. Selecting to cut the school system's funding by 7% while not considering a tax increase is a short-sighted decision. We should all be asking ourselves what is best for this community in 3 years, in 5 years, in 10 years. I challenge you to take the long-term view. Help us create a community where education and children are valued, a community where our employers and our parents can take pride in our school system and pride in the fact that we value children.
Thank you. Myers. Suzanne Brown? Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. My name is Suzanne Brown. I've lived in Alamance County for 22 years. And I was thinking earlier, I was going to say that I have no ties to Alamance County. I'm not born and raised. My husband was not born and raised. But I do have ties. I have a wonderful church family. I have tons of friends. And all of my children's memories are here. The concern that I have is for the school system and for the county in general. We love Alamance County. It has so much to offer, particularly in my mind, to young families. There are so many incredible opportunities with the park system and the music programs and the athletics. There are hundreds and hundreds of reasons why young families should choose Alamance County. There's one glaring reason why they should not. When I went to the NCGov site, I found that out of 115 counties, Alamance Burlington school system is 105th in their amount per pupil spending. Robeson County is the poorest county in North Carolina, and they are ranked 55th. My son will be a senior next year, and he wants to go into education. And I'm afraid to support him in that. I'm afraid not to support him because he would be an amazing teacher. But he has to be able to support a family because I expect grandchildren. If he does go into teaching, he won't come back to Alamance County. And if he doesn't come back to Alamance County, I won't be staying in Alamance County. If I was looking now, I wouldn't be coming to Alamance County. I would move to one of the surrounding counties and I would come visit Burlington because it has a lot to offer. But the primary goal needs to be support for the children, and we don't show that. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Suzanne. John, is it John Maley? Welcome, young man.
Good evening. My name is John Mayle. I've been in ABS schools since kindergarten. Since then, I've seen many changes in the classroom. My least favorite change was when we lost science kids due to budget cuts. I want to be a doctor someday, and it's very hard to learn science with no hands-on materials. I'm also an AIG student and was worried that resources might be cut next year. So I leave you with this. Please make education a priority in Alamance County so students like me will get the best learning experience possible.
Thank you, John. Ready, Shoe?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, I can't quite. I'm not up here to talk about what I came for. Came for mine. I'm somewhat concerned that we have a school superintendent, is she here? Mm-hmm. All right, that didn't know the budget meeting was the last meeting and has caused these apparently educated people to come out. After the budget meeting, hearing when this would have been more appropriate, I think that she saw the action the commissioners took and threw a temper tantrum, took our public, paid for website, took our speaker phones, dial phone that was supposed to be contact appearance for emergencies. And that didn't set a good example for kids. They all, everybody up here saying kids. Well, the rules don't apply to some people, apparently. They don't apparently apply to doctor, whatever her name is. The Ms. Tunica sat here and showed they was basically getting everything that they asked for. Getting a steal, she calls down the army. I don't understand why that she didn't come to y'all, why she didn't know the budget meeting first was, the past meeting. And then to mislead these people with the figures that showed up off the school board site, that or Mr. Honeycutt is throwing some figures at us that he got from out of state. I just want to register my disagreement and displeasure with the conduct that the superintendent has brought about with this type of act. Very disappointing.
Thank you, Mr. Shue. David Blair. Mr. Blair. Welcome, sir.
Good evening. How y'all doing tonight?
Good.
The concerns that you have heard and will hear tonight from parents regarding the quality of the Alamance-Burlington school system are important and should be important to anybody who wants to see Alamance County grow and prosper. Not just because the quality of the school system is something that is important to everyone who is looking for a place to relocate, a place to raise their family, but also because it is of primary importance to businesses that are looking for places to locate plants and offices. As a marketing consultant, I've worked with a number of economic development organizations outside of Alamance County. Focused on recruiting new businesses to their areas, these organizations take a close look at what companies look for when considering communities. One of the organizations I worked with surveyed CEOs and found that after you get past the basic concerns, is there a right building, are the highways in place, those kinds of things, a high quality K-12 school system is either the first or second item on their list. This finding is confirmed in Area Development's 2010 corporate survey, which found that 61% of respondents considered ratings of public schools important or very important. Commenting on this finding, one site selections consultant said his clients continue to place great emphasis on quality K-12 education and higher education factors because we see it as a complete pipeline for creating a capable workforce. Executives who have led successful business recruitment efforts also confirm the importance of K-12 education. Quoted in the Kansas City Business Journal regarding his work in Johnson County, Missouri, Bob Regnier, president of Blue Valley Bank, said, "Education drives everything." It's not unfair to say that Johnson County was successful because it had an unwavering commitment to K-12 education. Now, I don't want to downplay the importance of low taxes in business recruitment. In the Area Development Survey, about 80% of respondents cited the importance of corporate tax rates. The thing is, taxes function as the price of the package of value. Unless you deliver the proper package of value, you're not even going to get to a conversation about taxes. When shopping for a new site, businesses are like you and me when we go shopping for a new car. If, for example, you need a car that seats 5 comfortably, you're not going to look at all the ones that only have 2 seat belts in the back, even if they're thousands of dollars cheaper. After you've identified those that meet your wants and needs, you start haggling over price. So it is with tax rates and site selection. After winnowing out the communities that don't meet their criteria, companies start talking about tax breaks and incentives with those that do. In short, an Alamance County where homeowners enjoy rising home values, businesses enjoy increasing opportunities, and we all benefit from high-quality jobs begins not with low taxes, but with a first-rate K through 12 education system. I encourage you tonight to begin building that Alamance County by changing this conversation from how much to cut from our schools to how to fund a school system that can drive economic development. Thank you.
Next name I'm having a little trouble with. The first name is Doug. Yes, sir. Welcome.
What's the last name?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. I had a list of things that I was to discuss with you, but I sat beside of Mr. Evans, and me and him had some talks. But I would like to thank you, Mr. Manning, for your article in the paper. I sort of like what you said about Durham County forcing them to spend the school money. But this is what's confusing me that I've learned tonight. And I knew it a little bit before, but Mr. Evans has informed me a little bit. It seems like every time a newspaper comes out, the fund balance is 21 million, down to something else. Now I'm informed it's down to 12 million. Where is it at? The people, and I feel like the people of Alamance County is confused about the whole issue. They are confused about what's coming out from the paper. It reminds me of an old saying, he said, she said. You know, and to me, for the county to move forward, the two systems needs to get together. If you ain't already done it, if you have, you need to get together again and sit down and iron this problem out and move forward. It's not good politics for this to come in the paper every day about the fund balance and what's going on. I asked you the other month about putting a sales tax to help the county, okay? If we would eliminate, except for the school board, these outside agencies, like the Sword of Peace is one of them he was trying to think of, the arts, we could take a lot of these outside agencies. That's not part of the county government that I feel like we should not support. And if you'll watch, probably in the next month or two, because Mr. Osborne has done talk to the city of Burlington about funding a bus transit system. If it's not going out in the county to pick up people, if Burlington wants a school, a bus system, Graham wants it, they need to pay for it, not the county system. But if you add the sales tax to the ballot and use that money to support, I know it's got to say the sales tax, but you have the discretion to put on there, if it's passed, and explain it to the people that this sales tax would be used to support these outside agencies. And if it's money left over, school board needs it, or to go into fund balance. But we've got to look at it as the well is going dry, and we've got to do something to save the water. And it's, you know, I have supported the school system because I was one that did not apply myself like I should have in school. And that's one of my biggest regrets to this day. And I'll be 65 next month, and I still regret it. But
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sarah Walker? Ms. Walker? Welcome.
Hi, thanks for letting me speak. I'm Sarah Walker, and I'm a stay-at-home mother, and my husband and I are the very proud parents of a son at Elon Elementary School, and our daughter is finally, in her eyes, a rising high school student. I would like to challenge the commissioners to invest in the future of our county by investing in our school system. Year after year, I have filed the discussion of how large the cuts to the schools will be and which employees and resources will be cut. And I know that ABSS decides which programs will be cut, but if the money's not there, obviously we're not going to cut the core subjects. It's everything else that's going to have to go. I want to increase the resources allocated to our school and stop talking about the cuts. I believe, as do many of our local business leaders, that a strong school system will attract businesses and new residents, which will ultimately increase the revenue stream. Greater resources, which may have to come from a small tax increase, will allow the schools to innovate and not to stagnate. We want to produce Alamance County graduates who will be academically prepared for their futures, whether that includes attendance at our amazing state universities or working here in our county. As people who hire in this county, every single person that's being hired now, if you work at McDonald's, you need to know how to work a computer. If you work anywhere, you need to understand how to learn new things. The business world is changing on a daily basis, even in our little rural county here in North Carolina. And if we are not producing students who can go along with those innovations and help to lead them, we will suffer as a county. Now, we moved here 7 years ago, and we looked at the surrounding counties, and we decided we wanted to live here in Alamance County. And at that time, I believed this school system would be good enough for my children. It's no longer good enough for my children. And the cuts you're going to make are going to make it worse for my children. It's going to make it worse for the children who come along after them. I want my child to be proud, as my friends are, to say, I came through Alamance County school system. I graduated from an ABSS school, and I came back to this county to raise my family because I believe in this county. And I'm afraid that's not going to happen if we don't make a stand here and now. Now, many of you I've gotten to know over the past several elections. Many of you I've helped a little bit to get elected. I would like to say that I am proud to have helped this county commission make the right decision in education. I get a little disappointed when I come out to these meetings or other meetings where you all talk or I read in the paper this antagonistic relationship that is continuing between the schools and this county commission. We should all care about our children, and I challenge you to invest in their future now. Thank you.
Next is Mike. Help me, Mike.
Kerrigan?
Yes. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'll be very brief because I cannot improve upon the eloquence of all those who have spoken before me. I just want to join the chorus of Alamance County families that demand high quality education. And I want to say it in an election year, please raise my taxes.
Alan Moran. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the commissioners for having this hearing. I'm married. I've got three kids, 3, 6, and 9. The 6 and 9-year-old are in Alamance County School, Alamance Burlington Schools. I'm a tradesperson. I'm also a state employee. And I understand, we haven't had raises either, just like your county employees. And my heart goes out to them. They're miracle workers. They do more and more with less and less every year. That being said, I don't think we should be balancing the budget on the backs of our kids. I'd like to read some prepared statements here. Please give our public schools the money they need to be excellent. Public education is the best way we can nurture every kid in this county. The kids in Alamance County are gifted, talented, and creative. They come from different backgrounds with various varied skills and lofty aspirations, as we've heard this evening. Right now, we serve 23,000 kids in the system. Any cuts are going to substantially impact those kids. We cannot go backwards. A couple of points I'd like to make. Poorly educated students equals no skilled workers for the future. We're going to force businesses in Alamance County to hire people from outside the county for their skilled workforce. If the schools fail, so will our economy. It is short-sighted during an economic downturn to scrimp on schools. In order to recruit and retain a solid workforce in Alamance County, we need stellar public schools. The few counties that have fared well in this economy, in this economic restructuring, also have school systems that have attained high achievement scores on national tests. Also, we will never attract new industries who will bring new jobs to Alamance County if their top executives don't think that their kids can get a decent education. I thank the commission and I thank you for your time this evening.
We have a couple more speakers that are inside, but if you could perhaps invite the folks that signed up who are standing outside to maybe come up. They'll, Dave, can we get the folks that are outside and bring them up? Oh, I think they know who they are. Just tell them to come up and stand in the hall, because we'll get to them very quickly. Okay, well,
they're still there.
Yeah, they're there. Tracy Grazier, welcome.
Good evening. I'm Tracy, and I've lived here since 2000. And I'm here tonight to ask you to reconsider your budget and to make school funding a priority for this community. I'm very proud to have been raised by parents who value education. I've always been told that an education is the one thing in life that nobody can take away from you. However, I'm starting to wonder if that's true. As we've heard tonight, North Carolina is near the bottom of the state when it comes to per pupil funding, and North Carolina ranks 46th out of 50 states for K-12 funding. And now we're talking about further cuts. That is not what's best for the students of our community. Our county manager has recommended a tax increase. I'm asking you to put it back in the budget and to fund our schools and our other county programs properly. We want schools that are innovative, that provide up-to-date facilities, the latest technology, and best practices to our students so that they can compete in the global marketplace. It's really difficult to be innovative when your facilities are falling apart and you barely have enough money to fund basic curriculum requirements, and your teachers worry every year if they're going to have a job. As parents and concerned citizens, we're not the only ones who want good schools. So do the businesses who are looking to locate here. Any business who's being recruited to locate in Alamance County, who has followed the headlines over the past few weeks, and I can assure you that they do, is seriously considering if this is the best location for them. Making our schools a priority is a major economic decision for our county. I can tell you that my own family has had to do more with less. We've been affected by the recession with layoffs in my family, but we are willing to do more with less ourselves if it means that's what's best for our kids. I'm disheartened by the attitude of our county leaders towards our school system. It's very disheartening. So please, if necessary, raise our taxes, make education your top priority, and don't balance the budget on the backs of our kids. Thank you.
Thank you, Tracy. Chad and Rhonda Kessler or Kessler? Welcome, sir.
I've lived in Alamance County my whole life. Went to Southern High School. And my cause for being up here is I really do feel like that balancing the budget on some of the programs, like the athletics, would be a real big detriment to a lot of the kids. There are several state championships in this town, in this county. There are lots of kids that have gone to college on athletic scholarships. We currently have two that I know of, Brandon Tate and David Sapelt, playing professional ball that would not be possible if there were not athletics in this county. This county is full of athletic talent, and I really believe that there will be a lot of kids that would not have that possibility, obviously, if the athletics went away. I look at the American Legion team that's currently playing right now, and every kid on that American Legion team is from this county. If baseball went away, there would be no American Legion team for the kids to play in the summer. So that being said, I want to see more Davis Peltz and Brandon Tates in the NFL and the major leagues from this county. And this county is full of talent. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Kim Moore. Welcome. How are things out there? How are things out there?
Hot. That was good. Hi, I'm Kim Moore. I'm a business development director for Virtual Clinical Solutions. I am an Elon College, or Elon University now. That dates me a little bit, but I'm a graduate of Elon. I've been a citizen of Alamance County for 14 years, and I have a rising fifth grader at E.M. Yoder Elementary. I'm here to speak on behalf of raising taxes and educational funding. Perhaps it's a little late for this, but I want to express my disappointment that you voted against raising taxes to cover educational funding for this county. If a 2 to 3 cent tax increase, which constitutes an average of $30 per year, would solve the educational funding issue, it is truly remiss on your part to vote against such an increase. $30 amounts to a dinner for four at McDonald's. Taxpayers will never miss that. Those who you think might miss that money do not pay taxes. They don't own land. They don't own homes. With that being said, I'd like to address school funding. Yes, ABSS has a fund balance, just as any responsible citizen would. It's for unforeseen emergencies, such as heating and air conditioning, maintenance, technology. I'm sure some of you would be the first to complain if the superintendent did not allocate money for emergencies and ran into a shortfall. 5% cut last year, 7% this year. You seem to be punishing the superintendent and school board for responsibly managing their money. If this trend continues, will I be standing here next year with the same concern? These cuts equate to loss of teacher assistance, athletics, technology, music, arts, even things as simple as paper to make photocopies and worksheets. Other than perhaps law enforcement and citizen protection, I'd like to know what you consider more important than educational funding. These children, particularly the middle and high school children, will be the doctors of tomorrow that will care for you when you develop age-related illnesses and diseases. Do you really think it wise to cut their education funding? I applaud Dr. Cox and am very appreciative that she notified the parents of a possible threat to our children's education, and I will back her efforts 100%. Lastly, parents, citizens, and voters are taking notice. I can assure you that your decision to cut educational funding will be remembered in November. The responsible voting citizens of this county are pro-education, and we intend to elect commissioners who feel the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim. Paul Koontz.
Sir?
Paul Koontz. Good evening, sir.
Evening. How are y'all doing?
Good.
I appreciate you having us here tonight, and a lot of folks out there sitting on the hard ground and sweating and are very passionate about the cause. And I think the cause is Alamance County. It's not just the school. It's not just the county employees. It's the county as a whole. You know, as I sat outside sweating for the last hour, I was thinking about and listening to everything that was said in here. And you could hear it in people's voices that they care very much about the schools. I'm not so sure that we've got a budget crisis. I think that we have more of a crisis in leadership. And when I looked at The meeting that was on video, which I tell you, 2.5 hours of commissioners' meetings is a great thing to watch, from the last meeting. And perhaps we should have been here last month to talk more about the tax rate. Back in 09, when the revaluation went through, the idea was to make it revenue neutral. You reset the tax rate because, in theory, property taxes, the value of the property is going up. And we're trying not to hurt people too much with a big jump in the value of their real estate. Well, you know, it wasn't any of y'all's fault, but the fact is revaluation was a fiasco. But then what has happened over time is as people have appealed those values, the values have come down, but the tax rate has really not been reset to where it would be revenue neutral. And I've looked through the numbers. I've gone through the proposed budget Mr. Honeycutt has put together. And I really can't tell how close it is to revenue neutral or not, because you have new property coming online all the time. To me, the tax rate needs to be set where we're not giving property tax owners a tax cut, but at least we're holding the line and having the same amount of revenue coming in from the same property. That way, as new businesses come in and as new properties get built, that tax revenue goes up and is available for schools. If you look at the percentage of funding that's devoted to schools, that has gone down over the same period. Over the last 3 years, you've seen about a 3% decrease. Now, we all balance our budgets every week, every month in our households, and all we do is take the money that we have and figure out what we have to spend it on, what priorities we have. When I see the percentage of the budget devoted to schools going down, that shows me that schools are not the priority. It's not just about schools. County employees deserve a raise, too. Since 2008, they've had no increase. And we work with them on a weekly basis. We know they do a good job. I'd like to see both of those things put into the budget.
Thank you, Mr. Krantz. Thank you. Melvin Palacios. Good evening, sir, and welcome.
Good evening. My name is Melvin Palacios. I wanted to speak as a student. I say we need to keep these classes, mainly because I participate in some of them, like dance class. I am a dancer. Mm-hmm. And it has opened me up to so many levels. And like, I know a lot of students have been in like theater and like dance and all this other stuff, and they have opened up so much. And I mean, I've been in plays and I've learned that life is just great. And it takes a lot, you know, the students just need it. I've been in soccer, you know, I've made so many friends. There's just so much that a lot of students just need it, you know, and like it helps them find themselves. It really does. I mean, some kids have come in shy, like I've worked with them, and you know, by the end of the year, they're like one of the loudest kids. And it just, they really helps them find themselves. And it's just the main thing we need. And in the future, you know, they need their dreams. I mean, I've gone to New York and I've auditioned for like shows, you know, and I'm happy to say that I'm from Alamance County. And I know a lot of people have dreams, you know, and you know, they keep going for it. They're gonna be happy with what they're going for. I know a lot of people have their books and their studies and they wanna go for that too. You know, just let them, students speak too. The students can always speak and it should always be from their word, because from our perspective, a lot of this stuff actually does help us and it won't bring us down. Thank you.
Thank you. Is it Frida Sabria?
Frida.
I'm not sure I'm saying it right. Is it F-R-I-D-Y, it looks like. Freddie Sabrera, perhaps? Yes, sir. Sorry. Good evening.
Well, I'm just here to let y'all know that we need to keep our teachers, because thanks to the Fine Arts Building at Graham High School, it's kept me out of a lot of trouble. And I've opened myself up to more plays and helping out in the school. And I like giving back to the community now that my mindset has opened up to different things to do. And the athletics at schools, we need them, because we need more kids playing sports than outside at school trying to cause trouble. And that's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Kimberly Martin. Good evening.
Good evening. Mr. Chairman, Vice Chairman, Commissioners. Do you hear the music? Just experienced is a performance by the 2011 North Carolina Western Regional All-State Orchestra, which this Alamance County student held fifth chair on the bass. This orchestra is made up of 6th, 7th, and 8th graders from throughout the Western Region of North Carolina. Will you allow me, his mother, to be a living witness to your foresight, wisdom, and vision for the future? On June 6, 2006, two of you were here. 6 years ago, my son Gregory and I stood before you requesting that you remove from budgetary consideration cutting the arts from our public school system. I thank you for your wisdom and foresight at that time, which led to continuing funding of the arts in our public schools. Now I stand here to bring you a progress report of that insight back in 2006. We did not know at that time the extraordinary gift that lay dormant in our Gregory. Gregory had been in the Exceptional Children's Program exclusively until his second year of middle school, at which time we decided to attempt mainstreaming him in two classes, math and science. He had never taken an end of grade test before. In his first math EOG, he scored a level 3. I'm pleased to report that this year he also scored a level 3. What does this have to do with the arts, you may ask? Something miraculous happened during his second year of middle school, orchestra. After 1.5 years of playing the bass, he auditioned for the Western Regional All-State Orchestra, where he made fifth chair honors. And again, I'll repeat, this year, he made first chair honors. All due in part to the excellency of the Turrentine Middle School Orchestra Program under the direction of Mrs. Jody Gadke and the support of Dr. John Sulkowski, lovingly known as Dr. Ski, who retired this year. We miss you, Dr. Ski. Gregory had a book on building that day in 2006 when we stood before you asking you not to cut the arts from public schools. Because you did not cut the arts, you laid the foundation for his future, a future filled with great promise. We could not have known at that time that his career and passion for life was in the field of music, the arts. Imagine how many more lives you will touch by keeping these programs in our public schools and even finding ways to increase funding.
Thank you, Ms. Martin. Randy D'Angelo. Welcome, sir.
I'll be brief. I've been in the county since 96. I have six children. They've all come up through Alamance Burlington school system. I am a teacher and a coach at Southern Alamance High School. You've heard some tremendous people here this evening. You've heard from some wonderful people here in the county talking to you about the importance of education and the value of education in this county. I just would like to express that I think as leaders of this county that you will do the right thing. And that is a difficult job, but you've been elected as leaders to do the right thing. And we ask you to go back and do the right thing. Thank you.
Christopher McRae. Is it McRae or McCroy? Good evening, sir.
My name is Christopher McRoy. I'm a sales manager with the Washington Duke Inn in Durham. I have the opportunity each day to work with people from Wake County, Durham County, Orange County, and Alamance County. We've been here in Mebane since 2005. We lived in Cary for 6 months before we decided where to settle, and we actively searched for 6 months to find a place, a community where our children would grow, someplace that they could call home, a place where, you know, tall fences didn't make good neighbors, and they experienced probably one of the best elementary schools in the state when we were in Cary. When we settled here and chose Hawfields and Garrett for our children, we were 100% confident in that choice. My son had a reading disability, which was diagnosed in Wake County. He had every resource available to him here in the Alamance Burlington system. He went from a child that was 3 years behind grade level to a child that's currently 2 years above grade level and an AIG student. Because of the resources that were available to him in this county when we moved here. My children have participated in school athletics. Both have participated in chorus and in band. We compete every day to find folks to move into our county. I work, as I said, in Durham with folks in both counties. It's a difficult justification to parents with young families when they ask me, you know, how do you feel about the schools in your county? And I could say unequivocally, the first several years that we lived here, there was no difference between the experience I had here and the experience I had in Wake County. I have a hard time now when parents ask me, hey, should we move there? What do you think about Mebane? What do you think about Burlington? What do you think about Elon? We're putting ourselves at a competitive disadvantage if we're not doing the right things for our children. You know, when I moved here, I can tell you the fundamental choice had nothing to do with what my property taxes were going to be. It had everything to do with the opportunities that I could afford my child as a parent And if you look outside to the other 250 or more parents that are out there, I guarantee you property taxes were the last thing on their mind when they moved here. It was what we could do for our children. And at the end of the day, what I ask for you is that you honor that decision that we made as parents to be here. Not everyone was born and raised here. Many of us made choices to live here. And we just want you to honor those choices. Thank you. Thank you.
Brian Bolston. Good evening, sir.
Hi. My name is Brian Boylston. And my family and I live in Elon. And I'll be brief. Most of the people who come before me have expressed many of the same opinions that I have. I value K through 12 public education. I think it's the greatest investment that a society can make in itself. And I think that a better educated society is healthier, it's wealthier, and it's safer. I would like to see Alamance County substantially increase its investment in public education over the next 5 to 10 years. I would also like to say that I support the efforts that the school administration has made to keep parents up to date with what's been happening in public education. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Lee Wells. Good evening, sir.
Good evening to you all. And before I say anything else, would like to thank each and every one of you for your time, your patience, and for your service to this county. This is a very difficult decision before all of you. And I know that you all are doing the best you can and will make the best decision. So many before me have said some things very eloquently and very beautifully, and very touchingly, and they presented many facts and many ideas. I don't know how I can elaborate on those. I don't know how I can embellish upon those, but I do have three stories that I would like to share. First is short, the second, a little longer, the third, well, we'll see. The first story started back in 1999. My wife and I, our family, we lived in Chapel Hill. We were looking for a place to settle. We had our first daughter with us. We looked at Alamance County. We looked at Mebane. We looked at the quality of life. We looked at the quality of the schools in Alamance County and Mebane over Chapel Hill, North Carolina. That was extremely important to us. We were pleased with everything we saw. So in 1999, we moved here. We were out on Fifth Street in Mebane. The second story involves my oldest daughter, our oldest daughter. She had started school at South Mebane Elementary, and she was doing well, but not always focused, and she proceeded on to middle school, to Hallfields. And a wonderful thing happened called an AIG program in athletics and soccer. And she began to focus. She began to get her attention. It began to flow over into her studies. Her scores began to go up dramatically, her interest in education. When she reached Eastern Alamance High School, Eastern had her for 2 years. Because of the preparation and the excellence in the school systems when she came through, she was able to attend the School of Math and Science, where she graduated this spring with honors. We want that to continue. This county is capable of producing many, many more children like that. But we need your help. We need the funding, whatever it takes, whatever citizens can do. If we have to wash cars, it doesn't matter. Whatever it takes. The third story, and it's my final one, and I appreciate you for indulging me, involves a 13-year-old. Her name is Elizabeth. She's enrolled in Hallfields. She was a seventh grader, will be an eighth grader. She's ADHD. She's our daughter. She was wandering. She did not have an interest in school. And suddenly, three wonderful things happened. The AIG program at Hallfields, the band program at Hallfields, and the soccer program and athletics at Hall Fields. And because of that, she is now performing at the top of her class. It has her focus and attention. And we're still not sure how that story is going to turn out, but we think it has a chance to turn out tremendously. And I just want to add that I think there are hundreds and literally thousands of other children coming through the Alamance Burlington school system that can have the same experience. Let's help them out, folks.
Kimberly Daughtry. Welcome.
My name is Kimberly Daughtry, and we have lived in Alamance County for 26 years, my husband and I. And we chose a school system for where we were going to live years ago. The school system has allowed my daughter to enjoy arts. She's been in 40 different performances. She is in VIP choir with Miss Sam at Williams. She's had lots of opportunities to excel, and it includes her grades. She works hard with her grades because she knows arts are important, and that is something she truly enjoys. My husband and I, this is a different subject, but my husband and I received a postcard last week and thought, how much money did they spend on this postcard to send to everyone when they could have used the phone system we pay for once a year to let people know that the website was going to look different? So that concerns me when money gets spent on a postcard to tell you a website's going to look different, when that money and funding could be going towards the arts, music, mathematics, history. I love the schools, but like other parents have said, they've seen a decline in how things are operated. And I just wish that we could have the very best and that you can look into this and please try to save the arts and extracurricular activities for our kids. Thank you.
Thank you. John Oakes. Good evening, sir.
Hey, good evening. Appreciate the opportunity to speak this evening. I'd like to say before we start, if you would put ProPay on the ABSS system, I'll be happy to contribute above and beyond what I pay at 52% tax rate. So I just want everyone to know that my heart's in the right place, even though I may have a different opinion than some people here this evening. I paraphrase this, but it was Aristotle that said, a sign of an educated man is to be able to listen to someone without agreeing with them. And I hope that people listen to each other this evening. Our superintendent, Dr. Cox, recently announced she was working on a comprehensive strategic plan for Alamance Burlington school system. She calls the plan a public conversation around education. I am grateful to Dr. Cox for her vision and willingness to hear from and consider the comments and suggestions from everyone in the community as she begins drafting this comprehensive plan. Respectfully, I offer this to Dr. Cox and others for consideration on the board. I had the privilege to be a soccer coach and a substitute teacher here in the system for 1 year. I've raised two sons, my wife and I, and so I'm not coming from an abstract Disneyland mindset when I'm talking about education. Over the last 40 years plus, we have spent unprecedented amounts of money on public education, and I ask everyone respectfully, has that made our educational system better? We will spend over $7,500 per student in the ABS system this year. Is it rational to say that if we can only spend $7,300 per student, because that is all we have this particular year, that we are not investing in our kids' future? Is that rational, considering in many cases we have children in third world countries reading, writing, and outperforming American children that have only a fraction of the financial resources that our schools have? Objective data, not political data, supports that conclusion. Is it rational to suggest that just because there are cuts in funding, this fact in and of itself means we cannot properly prepare and adequately educate our children? Is it rational to suggest that just because a present program may have to have a cut to it, that somehow that equates to penalizing our students in education when we have to deal with monetary realities. The model of public education we have today in America is in sync with spending money. Nobody wants to hear this. Spending is the barometer that is used to measure success, and that is unfortunate, because we all know that spending more does not always equate with better. I believe that parents and the public have been conditioned to think that spending more money equates to better educating our students, because that is what is implied in our dialogue over the last 40 years. I know I don't have the time to finish, but I would just like to close with this final closing, and I apologize for taking so long. Respectfully, money and programs aren't the problem in our school system, and the vast majority of folks know it. But you won't see them showing up in numbers when it comes to your meetings or writing articles to the newspaper or emailing you. The majority is quietly and respectfully going about their business, paying their bills, working hard, and raising their families. Again, put the ProPay on the website, and there are many people like myself that would be happy to contribute to the schools above and beyond our tax rate. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, John.
This concludes the public comment period. I would like to sincerely thank each of you, not only for your comments, your input, but also for all of you for the courtesy you've shown during this public comment session. I think that is the way to continue a dialogue and provide input that is based on what you feel, and that's what we heard tonight. And very, very critical. Next item on the agenda are commissioner responses. We actually, for those of you that have not attended a meeting before, we have two times where we allow for commissioner responses. One is now immediately following public comments, and then again at the close of the meeting. So at this time, we'll have commissioner responses. And commissioners, only for our folks outside, when you speak the first time, if you could identify yourself, and they will know who is talking, as well as the folks in here. Are there any commissioner responses?
Yeah, I've got a couple.
You want to tell me?
Yeah, my name's Tim Sutton, and all I want to do is make a couple of points about some stats that were given tonight that I feel like were either in error or misrepresentative. I think the first one was given about the public school forum, where we were ranked 61st. I don't have that report in front of me, but I get it every year, and I look at it every year. And that chart has got many different categories of how they analyze figures. They are a very pro-school group. But I think they're objective. They ask the same questions of everybody, and if everybody's honest and gives the figures back, they compile the reports. I'm not sure about the 61st ranking, but I am sure that the last report that I saw, they had three categories that stand out as far as what I look at, as far as whether I think we're doing a fair job, not saying that we're doing the best that we could do, but we definitely could be doing worse. And that's not to validate, you know, this debate at all. I mean, I'm just making some comments here. Sorry if it appears that I'm trying to look the backwards way. Evaluations per student in our county. There was a ranking on that chart of property evaluations per student. They took the property evaluations of our county and divided it by the number of students, because that's where the money's got to come from, the property evaluations, basically. We were down the list out of 100 and some systems. We were very low on that list as far as what the property valuations were per student. They came up with another chart where it said on another page, our ability, what was our ability to pay into the public school arena. And from that, they took median incomes, indebtedness, again, evaluations, and they combined all these analyses, and they had us ranked higher than the evaluations per student as far as what our ability was. Then they had another chart of what our actual effort was. That's what we're putting into the system. And our rating in that public school form, the same report she's referring to, our actual effort was higher by many rankings over our ability. And our actual efforts were more by many rankings than our evaluations per student. Now, I don't know if it means anything to y'all, but it does mean something to me. Our actual effort is higher than our actual ability based on public school form. Now, you have to debate that with them if you don't agree with me on that. The comment about the 115 counties, first of all, there's only 100 counties. There might be 115 systems if you count the municipal systems, but there's 100 counties. That ranking of 105th, that ranking has been used for years in this debate. What that ranking is federal, state, and local money combined where we're ranked 105th, if that's the true ranking. It's not just county money. It's federal, state, and local money. It took me 2 years of asking school administration prior to Dr. Cox, under Dr. Merrill, and also Dr. Williams, why was our ranking that low? Because I didn't understand it. You look on one chart, it had 105th. Then you go over to the other chart of actual county dollars put into the system, we were ranked like 45th or whatever. We were way up the ladder. 105, it's deceiving to say that's what our local effort is, because that's not the case. And the answer that we got back, I think it was from Dr. Merrill after asking for about 2 years, why was that ranking that way? Again, I got an ambiguous answer at first. We don't know. And then finally the answer came back, well, we think it's the tenure of our teachers, that because of that tenure, that the federal and state dollars were lower than other people, but our county dollars were higher, much higher than well, 50 other systems. That's not to say that's where we want to stay. No, I'm disappointed that our per pupil funding level has dropped to where I asked the county manager, because I've always looked at the charts of the systems that are truly our peer groups, what I think are truly our peer groups. And those are systems that give or take 2,000 students or better. Where do we rank with per pupil money? There's roughly 14 school systems in the state of North Carolina that's got the same per pupil level, the same number of students that we've got, give or take 2,000 students. There are 14. For years, we have been ranked about 7th in that 14 category. 6 above us, 7 below us. We were ranked 7th. Our per pupil funding level, 2 years ago, according to what Craig Honeycutt gave me tonight, because I asked for this. I'm concerned about this. But how we go about answering it, I'm not sure you agree with what we might do tonight or later, whatever. But our funding level per pupil, and that's a benchmark. That's not a scientific measure of involvement. It's not a scientific measure of success or unsuccess, but it's a figure that people look at. They take the number of dollars put in the system, divide it by the number of students, and you come out with a per pupil figure. But it's not scientific. Everybody knows it's not scientific. It's not really that academic, because you have smaller systems where the money that goes in is much higher than a bigger system. Davidson County is a good example. They have 18,000 students in their county system, and their funding level is probably $300 to $400 per pupil lower than Lexington and Davidson. So are you gonna, Lexington and Thomasville, so are you gonna come along and say that Lexington and Thomasville is doing a better job at educating their kids due to per pupil funding than the county, Davidson? And I said, academically, I don't think you can even ever come close to winning that debate, that argument. But the per pupil funding level for our system has dropped $200 per student from 2 years ago to tonight, $200 a student. And I predicted it was going to be about $180 to $190 per student. If you just do the math, that's disturbing. It should be disturbing. But why did we get there? How did we get there? Did we overfund the system to where now that the money's being not given or theoretically in a way taken back? Is that causing it? Yes, that's what's causing it. In my opinion, in accounting or in budgeting, if there hadn't been some over budgeting, and I believe there was. Now, that's not to say anybody's crooked or anybody's deceiving, but as a result of over budgeting, possibly, you got the funding level brought down as a result of having money in a fund balance, that now some people are saying, well, you can run your system off of that for a couple of years while we balance our budget. Yeah, I don't like the fact that our funding level per student is going to be shown to be $200 less per student than it was 2 years ago, because that is going to show up in public school forum. It's going to be shown in every other report BPI puts out and so forth. Those are just facts and figures. Whether you like them or not, I don't like them. I don't like some of them. I don't like how we got there, and I don't like why we got there or how we got there. On a positive note, when I heard the orchestra, I thought that was professional. I honestly did. That was impressive. Who was the composer on that? Does anybody know? Anybody? Well, I was thinking it was Mozart. Who? I don't know who Mozart is. But I don't know who. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Commissioner Sutton. Other comments?
Well, I guess I'm not understanding either why we're saying now, Mr. Honeycutt's saying the school's going to get exactly what they've asked for or more. So I know Jackie's shaking her head no, but Mr. Honeycutt has showed you this. So that's what I'm not understanding with this whole situation, is if the figures are there, you know, why are we not using these figures? That's what I want to know. So,
thank you, Ms. Bassett. Mm-hmm. Other comments?
Well, this is Eddie Boswell speaking.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The ones outside. That was Linda Massey. Anyhow, I appreciate all of you coming out tonight. It's been a lot said, a lot of good things, a lot of programs that have been talked about, maybe being cut, this, that, and the other, but it's not going to be our decision what programs get cut within the school system. It's not. I mean, the arts, the music, those kind of things are going to be up to the school board, to the superintendent as to what they put value into. Unfortunately, you guys are 2 weeks late. I mean, we've already set a tax rate 2 weeks ago. Now we're trying to work with this and try to make this work for everybody concerned. In the school, the county's had to step up. Everybody else is stepping up. We did set a tax rate, probably the wrong thing to do without a budget. But anyhow, it's done. It's a done deal. So, we do have to deal with it now. I don't know what the pleasure of the board is tonight. I'd hate to see us lose a lot of the programs that you're talking about. Mr. Smith, I think he just walked out, but it would be nice to have these numbers and really be able to figure out what's what, because I know Craig's giving us numbers, you guys shaking your head, and this communication gap is not a good thing. And we need to work on that and try to figure out what's what. And then we can know how to deal with it. But, you know, we've got to cut a lot of things, as you saw in the beginning. And unfortunately, you know, we're going to look like the bad guys, but we're not. I mean, our hearts are not that we want to cut out education. I'm speaking for myself. The rest of them say what they want about it.
Thank you, Mr. Boswell.
I don't have anything to say.
This is Tom Manning, and it's difficult for me to hear a lot of these comments implying that the commissioners don't support in a big way public education. Prior to joining this commission, I served on the school board for 12 years, 5 as its chair. And I saw and I experienced a lot of what you heard tonight, the budget discussions of several years ago, the perception that the county commissioners and the school board members don't get along. We get along. We really do. We don't agree all the time, but we get along. As far as my personal commitment to education, my wife's a school teacher. My sister's a teacher's assistant in the Alamance Burlington school system. Her daughter goes to the School of Science and Math in Durham. My kids went through music and athletics. One of my daughter's orchestra teachers is sitting right here in the balcony. My stepkids are involved in athletics and in music. I have a personal commitment to the arts. I'm still involved in the arts. I'm part-time at Alamance Community College. I value the importance of teaching, so I hope that you understand, and I think I am speaking for all the commissioners when I say we do have a strong commitment to public education. It is the largest recipient of county funds. Something over 28% of our county budget goes to public education. And frankly, when we do comparisons, and we can find numbers to support our cause, can't we? When you look at our comparison, the similar size schools, we have just about the highest percentage of funds that go to education compared to any of our similar size counties and school systems. We really do. So it's not about your commissioner's malintent to disregard public education. It's not. And I don't think it was 10 years ago when I was on the school board. I really don't. I think it's a matter of our commissioners who receive requests from many different departments and agencies. You saw a partial list of them to allocate those funds to meet the total needs of the county. And if we didn't do that, we wouldn't be addressing the needs of the citizens who've charged us with looking at that. And that means fiscal accountability. It means having to prioritize and make the tough decisions like we're looking at tonight. There is a lot of information about, and some of you said it directly, about specific programs that could be on the chopping block. That was in the budget message coming from your school superintendent. Looking at the numbers, it does not support the need to cut programs for fiscal year 2012-2013. It just doesn't do it. And I don't want to bore everybody with a big, long fund balance history and discussion, but I've watched the fund balance. I've watched it since school merger in 1996. You know, what is the fund balance? It's the school system savings account. How does it come about? It comes about because the school system spends less than it's receiving, and that's good. That's very good. We should do that at home. But once you get to a certain point where your school system reserve fund is of the amount that Alamance Burlington's is fortunate enough to be in right now, then it's time to balance that a little bit with the rest of the needs in the county. That doesn't mean that this budget year is going to be the same as next budget year. It doesn't mean this budget year is the same as last budget year. But it does mean that we're working with what we have today. In today's economic environment, where unemployment is still 9.5%, and one of our speakers talked about rising, I think it was Mr. Blair, talked about rising home values. We don't have rising home values right now. And there are a lot of folks that are concerned about that and what that means to the next 18, 24, 36 months of what's happening in our county. A percentage was thrown out about the school fund balance percentage being 6% or 8%. The school fund balance in Alamance Burlington can only come from the allocation from county dollars. There's no fund balance from the state or federal dollars. It's all county dollars. And if you look at the fund balance as of June 30th, 2011, which is the last audited figures that we have, and we received those numbers in October, that percentage was over 60% of the annual operating budget. Now that's fact, and that's in the audit from the school system. That's a high number, and we are fortunate to have that because we can use that during a time when revenues that our county generates have fallen. And they've fallen because property tax value has come down, sales tax volume has come down, our fees and services from things like the jails and other services are all in decline. And we've put in programs and methods to turn that around, but it's not going to be immediate. And what we hope to see and what we budget to see is an improvement in all those areas in the coming year, which means next year when we're looking at this same situation, hopefully things will be different. I certainly hope they'll be different. But the fact is, when we talk about fund balance and all these numbers that are going out, it is confusing. It's confusing, it's very technical, and it's very, very complex. school system receives dollars from three different sources. We've talked around that: federal dollars, state dollars, and county dollars. We're concerned with that portion of that total budget that's right here. It's about $34 million. That's what the county provides to the school system on a total budget of 170-some million dollars, roughly a third. And that is the third of the school budget that we're talking about here. And what I would submit, again, not emotion-based, but fact-based, is that through a combination of the county allocation, what the school system will receive from state and federal sources, and what they will use from the fund balance, it will not at all be necessary to change or curtail or cut any of the programs that you all have mentioned that are so important to you, and important to me, and important, as you all said, to the vibrancy of this county. So what I would like to do, and several of you said this too, when we talk about a dialogue, you know, this issue is not about orchestra in high school. This issue is about the county's commitment to public education. And the school advocates feel that the county is not committed to public education, and folks at the county question some of the use, the allocation of the funds that the school system receives. We have asked over the past year or so, specifically last December, for the school system to help us develop a fund balance policy that would address the very thing we're talking about, so this kind of uncertainty would not occur. And that's what we want to do. And we want to continue to do that and have that dialogue where school administration can meet with county management, come up with something that's good for all parties, and present it to the board and present it to the school board. And several of you all have said that. We need to communicate. We need to communicate with each other and not through the media, because that's when all these tales get started and we start questioning all the figures. So I'm hopeful that as we go forward, we can put in place the kind of relationship that would earn your trust in both boards, and that we would earn the reputation that would make counties want to move here and want to expand here, so that we don't have this kind of noise out there that provides an excuse for companies not to be here. Because in the long term, it is, as many of you said, that is the key to having a bigger property tax base that we can fund more agencies.
And we'll start by your county manager telling us.
Patsy, this is not the time. Patsy, this is not the time.
He did not.
Patsy.
He could have shared that information with us, and we could have had a dialogue so that we could have sat here tonight and not be surprised.
Patsy,
and
you're,
gave him input.
Patsy, you're
so
out of
he
order.
He would be more informed. You're, and he did not Patsy. Share that with
you're
us.
You're out of order, Patsy.
I don't like the
cop. You what? He didn't. So, again, I do appreciate your all's input. And I see a couple of you shaking your heads in the wrong way. And that's fine. But what I would challenge each of you to do is if you are really interested in the funding part, then let's learn the rules. Let's learn what it is. And by the way, the fund balance got as large as it did because when the county made an allocation to the school system in years past, if the county didn't use all the money, if the school system didn't use all the money, they kept it for their fund balance. And the county did not object to that. The county didn't say, well, let's give it back. But there is no legal obligation that the school board, the school system, even has to have a fund balance. So it's there. It's a balance, allocations versus reserves. Let's get through this year. No programs need to be cut, and let's start studying now for what happens in the future. And those are my comments. There isn't anything else. Let's move into item six, which is a discussion of the fiscal year budget, which I guess we've already had. The what?
We need to add on the,
no, the property
tax.
Insurance. Thing.
We need the Fawcett fire chief to
speak. As part of the budget. You want to do it? You want to do that now?
Well, the Fawcett, yeah, but that fiscal insurance and vehicle.
Yeah, but that's after.
Yeah.
That's after. Well, but I think what Craig's saying is we were going to hold off on the appointment until after we heard from the fire chief. Is that right? Okay. And is that person here?
Yes.
So let's call on
the chief.
Okay.
Oh, there he is.
Good evening and welcome.
I'd like to start off apologizing for not being here June 4th. It was a miscommunication between myself and the fire marshal's office. And I was told one date, and I was wrong. So I apologize for that. This year, we're asking for a 0.5% increase in our budget. Currently, we're 8.75% proposed tax rate, going up to 9.25%. With the 0.5% increase, it would bring us in an additional $25,000, roughly, along those lines. Currently, we have three loans that we're paying on annually. Two truck loans and a bottle loan, an hour bottle loan, for roughly about $73,000 we're paying yearly. We have about $185,000 in salary. We need to increase to hopefully pay down a lot of these loans, maybe pay off some of these trucks. Also, with the increase, it would help with the increase of operating costs of the fire department. Everybody knows electricity is going up, diesel fuel is going up, natural gas to run the station is going up. Like to give the employees a little bit of raise throughout the year. With the increase in the budget, you know, that would help our financial situation out some. Also, with the increase, the fire department needs a lot of cosmetic updates. Our parking lot's in poor shape. We have asphalt coming up, becoming chunks. It's becoming a hazard to the community. Our fire department is open for the public, for meetings, parties. It's become a hazard. Putting the fire department at a liability, we'd like to start resurfacing it. Possibly concrete net. A rough estimate on that job is about $100,000. Remodeling inside, we'd like to do a little addition, make a living room for our paid guys, and on one side, put an exercise room for physical conditioning of firefighters to help them out with their health issues, do some cardiac work with them, try to maintain their medical condition like that. Also, the roof at the station, it's going to need some attention immediately. I ain't going to say immediately, but in the near future. It's a flat roof. It's retaining water. We have noticed leaks inside the station. We're not asking for a lot. We're just asking for a 0.5% increase. I think our last increase was 2007.
How many full-time employees?
Yeah. We have full-time employees. We have three that works 24 hours a day, then we have one 8-to-5 guy Monday through Friday, and roughly about 36 volunteers.
What's the rating we call it? ISO, whatever?
Yeah, ISO rating.
Is it ISO? Okay.
Can't remember. It's a class 7 right now. We just went through a rating in June of 2011. We maintain the 7. We was real close to a class 6. Talking to the state fire marshal's office, Bernie Ward, he gave us some suggestions that we could do to hopefully get to the class 6. And one of those things was some equipment on trucks. So I persuaded my board into buying $10,000 worth of equipment to put on these trucks. Hopefully, within the next 12 months, we'll be re-rated and hopefully get that class 6 to help the homeowners with their fire insurance rating.
What's your balance in your...
The cash and investment balance that I got, and this from Brown, Ezekiel, and it was the end of December. It was like $285,000.
$285,000?
Yes, sir. And our annual budget is $345,000, somewhere around there. Yeah, our annual, well, last year's budget was $345,000. With the half cent increase, it would bring it up to $370,000. With that half cent increase, if we get it. And like I said, it's only.
Have you got any debt payouts or anything that you got to use this $285,000 for, or is that just?
Well, it's sort of like keep a year.
So you don't have any immediate debts that you're going to be paying off or anything like that?
We got some that we're trying to work slowly down. We got two truck payments and also that air bottle payment. Right now, they're on the yearly payment plan. As far as that $285,000, there's no immediate use for it right now. That's just cash and investments, what we have in CDs and money markets and stuff like that.
Did Fawcett lose any of their property to the city expansion?
We've lost very little. I'd say just a few houses that's been annexed. They're not really concentrating in that area right now.
Okay.
They're more concerned about another area right now. So we hadn't been affected by their annexation.
When you had your public hearing, I guess you did, right?
Yes, sir.
Did you have any objections to your tax increase?
Well, March 13th was the public hearing, and also it was the board meeting all in the same day. We advertised it just like Honeycutt Burgess has asked us to do in the past. We advertised it. Nobody showed up. Okay. So nobody from the community come in.
What's your rate now?
8.75. And proposed is 9.25. 50-cent increase. Well, half been.
Do we need to vote on that one?
Other questions for Chief Westbrook?
Yeah.
Mr. Honeycutt, do we need to vote this separate, or how do we do the other? We voted on the full budget for the other volunteer fire departments.
Right. This probably needs to be done separately.
Okay, let's address that now then.
Yeah, I'd like to ask a question about the fund balance of our fire marshal. Is that a standard balance? Is that high in your opinion, low, average for their size and their operation?
As the chief mentioned, he'd like to try and have close to a year's worth in there if possible. Probably about average of what most of the counties are having for
department size. Well, it sounded like from your list of needs there, you had more than that amount in needs.
Got quite a bit.
You need to address, right?
Commissioner Sutton, would you like to address in conjunction with this subject the appointment, or do you want to take that separate? This was the item that
I apologize. I thought that was the budget item.
No, this is an appointment, I think, to the Fawcett Fire District Board.
Yeah, okay. No, I don't have an interest.
You're okay with
that? Yeah, I'm okay with that.
Okay, can we put that back on consent?
Yeah, I apologize.
Item number A3, which is the appointment to the your board.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we're strictly talking about the budget and the half cent increase. Okay. Is there a motion to approve the request by Chief Westbrook as it relates to a half cent increase on the Fawcett Fire District?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Lashley and second by Commissioner Boswell. Is there any other discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Commissioner. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Discussion of fiscal year 2012-2013 budget. Greg's not going away.
Where we're at is if the board agreed to the original cuts, not the Susan, if we can go back
to that screen
to the process. If the board agrees with those cuts
and also agrees with the revenue change to social services. That will give us a balanced budget with respect to the fiscal year 12-13 at 52 cents, and our budget ordinance would be based upon those changes.
Further discussion from commissioners on the proposed 2012-2013 budget?
I want to reiterate it, underline it, stamp it. When we see the trend is not going to be there, we've got to address it emphatically.
Yes, sir.
And don't.
Well, and again, that's exactly what we did in October.
That's how this,
and
what happened this year.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we addressed it, but it was like a little soft balloon that we lit up.
Right.
And no offense, if you want to grab it, we grab it. Right. And look what happened. You know, if the trend is not there after one quarter, we cut more.
Yes,
there's other things we can cut, we'll cut.
Yes, sir.
And with the majority vote. And,
yes,
and you know, because we cannot go a dime into that fund balance.
Yes,
we don't need to.
And the same thing should happen after the second quarter.
Yes,
right.
Sir. Right.
And the third quarter.
Yes, right. Sir. Yes, sir.
But we cannot let it get out of hand.
Yes, sir.
Other comments? Is there a motion to approve the manager's amended recommended budget for 2012-2013?
So moved.
Mr. Lashley, Mr. Sutton. First and second, any other comments or discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Budget's passed. Thank you. Next item, we pulled the item D, Property Insurance Fund Financial Plan. Commissioner Lashley, would you like Mr. Honeycutt to present that, or do you have specific questions?
Yeah. It's just a budget amendment. It was already approved. The funding is there.
You approved it several months
right.
ago. We put the insurance out to bid. This is just actually moving. We went self-insured.
Kind of
self-insured. So this is moving the money from the general fund into the new
insurance
property fund. Yeah.
Just for a separate.
Yeah, and the money's already there
yes.
in the
so
general
we're going to save, the county's going to save money by doing
yes,
it.
Sir.
That's what I thought.
How much
savings?
Okay.
You pulled three off.
Okay,
A3.
Yeah, that's true. Your concerns addressed?
Right, yes.
Okay.
Okay, we can put that back on.
Well, no, our county attorney is correct. Point of order, we do need to have and entertain a motion, first of all, on the
A3.
Fawcett Fire District appointment. Is there a motion that, who is it?
There's three appointments.
Okay, well, let's read them. There's Elon.
Tim
Bennett. You find him, Eddie?
Tim Bennett.
Yeah, here we go. Yeah, Mr. Tim Bennett, Mr. Brock
Jones
and Mr. Danny Langley Jr. Is there a motion that these three individuals be appointed or reappointed to the Fawcett Fire District Voluntary Board, Advisory Board, excuse
so
me.
Second.
Bill second by Mr. Boswell. I did. Any discussion? All in favor say aye. Any opposed? Okay, now as Mr. Albright pointed out, we need a motion to address the approval for the Property Insurance Fund Financial Plan. Item D that was on the consent agenda was pulled. Is there a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
We'll give that one to Ms. Massey. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye. Any opposed? Very good. Takes us down to the county manager's report.
Nothing this evening.
Hearing none.
We did at our last meeting vote to cancel the July 2nd meeting. So just announcement on that.
So the first and only meeting in July will be 16th of July,
yes,
and that'll be back in our regular quarters.
Yes, sir.
Great. Any further now commissioner comments?
Yep.
Any announcements? We do have one announcement, actually. I think everybody received an invitation, and certainly everybody's invited here too. The new Sheets in Graham is opening, and they're having a grand opening Thursday at 10:45. And the significance is, obviously, it's new business. They're going to employ between 45 and 50 people. They're here without any economic incentives. They're here because it's a good business environment to operate. They will complement their stores in Burlington and also in Mebane. So that's Thursday. If you want to participate, we'd love to see you down there. Commissioners, any other announcements? Not. Stand adjourned. Thank you.